Hello, everybody. I'm Laura McGath from the Apold Planetarium at Lourdes University. We're so glad that you joined us today on Earth Day. Now, when you think of NASA, you probably think of rockets flying up into space and astronauts walking on the moon. But there's a lot more that NASA actually does, and that includes looking at Earth. And we're here today here on Earth Day with Dr. John Bolton. He is a physical research scientist at NASA, and we're so glad that you joined us. Thank you so much, Dr. Bolton.
Thank you, Laura. I'm very excited to be here.
Now, when most people think of NASA, they think of space exploration. What's NASA's connection to Earth?
Well, that's a very good question. You know, since the beginning of NASA, one of our main missions has been studying our home planet, and that's Earth. And it turns out that one of the best places to study the Earth is not necessarily from the ground, but it's from space. So by leveraging satellite observations, we have a very unique vantage point. You know, we can get a global view of what's happening. We have frequent overtime passes, and we can cover a large area in a short amount of time. So it gives us a wonderful opportunity to complement the work that's being done on the ground by scientists.
So, but is there any science that can only be done from space? Is there any data that you couldn't get any other way?
Yeah. In fact, yes, certainly. Because I think, for example, one of my favorite missions that NASA is involved in is called GRACE. It's the Gravity Recovery and Climate Experiment. And it's
gravity
not a
recovery?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, check this out. So it's not a satellite looking down at the Earth. It's actually two satellites flying in tandem. They're looking at each other. They're not looking down. So they're separated by around 200 kilometers, and they're measuring this horizontal distance within the accuracy of one red blood cell. It'll blow your mind, right? Okay, so this horizontal distance changes because the first one may be pulled forward a little bit because of mass on the ground, if there's a large mountain, for example. Okay, now they do this over and over and over, okay? That change, that they're measuring this horizontal distance, they measure the anomalies, a change from 1 month to the next. If there's a change from 1 month to the next, that mountain really isn't moving that quickly, but water does. Glaciers do. We're seeing that change in mass, you can infer a movement of water. So the short answer is we're measuring groundwater from space. So I'm a hydrologist. I'm a water scientist, right? And then in our business, the big question is like the delta Q. Your residual from your water budget is always groundwater because you can't really sense groundwater easily. Now we have a direct observation of groundwater that really can't be done from the ground. So that's just one example of how NASA is studying the Earth and sort of helping inform decision-making related to groundwater movement, for example.
Right. Well, regarding decisions, the Apold Planetarium, we're at the western edge of Lake Erie, and the Great Lakes are really important to us. How will the research at NASA affect Earth and the Great Lakes?
That's a great question, Laura. So within NASA, by leveraging satellite data, okay, let's, for example, in the Great Lakes region, if you're interested in how that water is changing, what if you're interested in water use, water supply, you know, the health of that water, we can study water quality from space. We also, NASA is very involved in looking at changes in sort of how the water is moving, where the water is, and where the water isn't. If you're interested in transboundary water issues, if a water source is being shared across a political boundary, for example, using satellite data, it helps give sort of a very good perspective of that water source. And I just mentioned the groundwater component. So it's very, very helpful for groundwater transboundary, you know, issues, if you will. But there's so many examples of how this is being done. Water quality, you can look at sort of since NASA's been launching satellites for over 50 years now, we have a long legacy, historical record of the Great Lakes region, for example. So we can see how changes in perhaps urban sprawl or industry may be influencing the health of these lakes, or if you're interested in public use of the lakes, you can see how that's changing as well.
You can go back to your older satellite data and see how the lakes are changing.
Absolutely. And I think that's a really, really big part of what NASA does. And for Earth Day, and you can visit, I'll just give a shout out at nasa.gov/earth. And also you can find us at hashtag connected by Earth. There's many, many examples of NASA Earth science addressing so many issues. You know, it blows my mind. I've been doing this for over 15 years and I still get giddy about it. We can measure the height of the Great Lakes within the accuracy of 3 centimeters from a satellite over 200 kilometers in space. It just blows my mind, right? So if you're interested, say, okay, well, let's take this. If you're sourcing your irrigation with groundwater, you know, how is that groundwater changing? How much water is being used by those plants? You know, we can not only see what type of plant there is, we can see how healthy the growth and senescence of that plant. And this might blow your mind even more. We can even see sort of the flux of a photosynthetic, the amount of energy that's used for photosynthesis by a plant. When a plant goes through photosynthesis, it gives off a little bit of energy. Actually, it gives off something in the Fraunhofer line, if you want to be super nerdy about it. And you can measure that from space. So we're seeing the amount of energy being used by a plant for photosynthesis. And wow, we're tying this into health, to plant health. It's super cool.
Yeah, and I'm guessing most of us probably are completely unaware of that. I'd also like to follow up on that. In 2019, you received an award from the Department of State for your work on the U.S. Global Water Strategy. Could you tell us more about that work and how can we have a strategy of water for the whole world?
Thank you, Laura, for asking that. That's a wonderful question. So we've been working with many other U.S. agencies that are interested and having a better perspective of water use, water resources, and water security. And we're seeing water security is a major, major issue. You know, I often tell my family that my daughter is 8 years old. By the time she's my age, there'll be nearly 10 billion people on this planet. There's 7.4 people now. So what is her relationship to water going to be? And how is it changing? So we're working closely with agencies through the Department of State to have a better understanding of global water resource management and water security. And through the Global Water Strategy, this is sort of a collaboration of all U.S. agencies that in one way or another are addressing water security. So we're trying to get sort of a complementing view of some, the USGS does wonderful work by studying river dynamics, for example. How do we improve the accuracy of their river dynamic models? We can actually do that by tying that into satellite observations.
Right. And not every country is going to have the same satellite resources that the United States does. So we're also sharing that resource, that expertise.
Exactly.
Right. Now, you've also done a lot of work on flood and risk management, but aren't floods just inevitable? How can people actually really prepare for floods?
Oh, that's a great, great question, Laura. And it's an active area of research. And I think the way that to understand flooding, for example, a flood is an extreme that's realized in the rivers, right? For example, and the best way to do this, how can we forecast that flood? A lot of NASA Earth Science work is done to sort of predict and mitigate disasters, for example. Flood rate. I live about a mile from Ellicott City, Maryland. Ellicott City, Maryland has suffered more than 3,000 year events, flood events, in the past 10 years. Okay. So we are partnering with the Maryland Howard County Office of Emergency Management to inform their decision-making processes by providing and building a flood forecasting system that leverages satellite data. So we take in precipitation data, temperature data. We can also sense the amount of soil moisture that's in the ground from space using a microwave sensor. Super cool. So that sort of the amount of moisture in the soil is very, very relevant for flooding. So if it rains over a saturated surface, you're gonna have increased runoff, right?
So if the soil's really dry, then it can absorb more of that rain.
Exactly, exactly. So we have satellites. There's a satellite called SMAP. It's the Soil Moisture Active Passive Mission. It's leveraging passive microwave emission from the Earth. And that microwave emission is very highly correlated with the volume of water in the 1 to 5 centimeters of soil. And we tie that into a flood forecasting model. And it helps constrain or helps drive that model towards reality. I mean, the name of the game is just every opportunity you get, have a direct observation of what's happening. You know, when we model the Earth, that's a numerical representation of nature. That's sort of our best guess. But, you know, nothing beats going outside and seeing, you know, how, if I should put on a jacket or a sweater, right? You know, and that's what we're doing with the satellite observation. And we can do that. And we have a wonderful array and constellation of satellites, over 18 Earth observing satellites that are capturing different elements of the water, energy, and carbon cycles.
Oh, I guess I'm guessing most people are completely unaware of how many satellites we have just looking at that kind of data. And so help us understand the data that they're getting. So can they tell how deep in underground the water is? Can they tell if it's salt versus fresh, clean versus contaminated?
Absolutely, absolutely. So first of all, I will give another shout out. If you're interested, we are using hashtag connected by Earth for Earth Day. So NASA has a very large campaign of many examples of how we're doing this. The short answer to your question about salinity is absolutely. In fact, we use the same microwave based sensors, and they're sensitive to salinity in the oceans, for example. And this is very, very important for climate science, for example. If you have a climate model, the density of the water, the amount of salinity in that water, the temperature of that water, the upwelling from the west coast of Africa, for example, can be captured and viewed and modeled and predicted and better understood by doing this. And the whole idea is trying to understand, how is the Earth working, you know? And it all comes back to making observations, working with other people, working with brilliant people like you all at Lourdes University, and seeing if we can work together and work on this. So I do encourage everyone to please visit nasa.gov/earth. Check it out. We have a lot of people there. And we're also very interested in citizen science. This is a major element of what NASA is doing. So we're collaborating with people all around the world to see, hey, you know, what do you have? And we want to work with you and see what you're doing. And we have many, many fun apps that you can use just simply on your cell phone. It's very, very cool.
Right. So citizen science is a way for people, ordinary people, to get involved in doing real science.
That's right, Laura. Absolutely.
Now, sometimes, though, this whole idea of building models of our whole planet just seems so complicated. How can we just be so sure about climate change?
Ah, well, it comes back to, I think, scientific literacy, right? Just informing ourselves like we're doing right now and trying to understand what our relationship is to the Earth. And that all comes down to observing what's happening. That's the essential root of what science is, making an observation. And that's what NASA does best, right? So we're working not only from satellite, we have many ground-based observations and airborne campaigns as well, and trying to make a long historical record of the changing Earth. And in fact, we're seeing significant changes in our Earth due to human-induced climate change.
Right. But sometimes it feels like the changes that we're seeing are somewhere else. Maybe a glacier's melting. Is it really affecting us here in the Great Lakes region? How is global warming going to change my life living here over the next few years?
And that's a wonderful and important question. I'll tell you what. We're seeing, for example, from dust storms in Africa, when that dust and particulates is carried over west to the U.S., that affects our climate in the United States. We're seeing the change.
From Africa is going to affect us.
Absolutely, absolutely. Okay. So is what you're seeing. So in fact, from A good example, last year during, we had a record number of forest wildfires in the western states.
Right. And I remember.
You could see that from space. You could see the clouds of smoke, the plumes there. But the short answer for how climate change may affect folks in the Great Lakes region, when you have melting glaciers, you're introducing fresh water into the oceans. This fresh water has a different density than the warmer salt water. In fact, it sits above the warmer salt water. And this is affecting the circulation of the oceans. The reason we have climate, the reason we have weather is really from the circulation of the oceans. So this is driving a lot of global climate and local weather. So there, it is all tied together. It is a system. And I do encourage everyone, please go back to nasa.gov/earth, check it out. There's many, many cool examples there.
Right. I've been there, and there's a lot of fun things to do at that website. And it's a way to help people put the pieces together, because the Earth does seem like a really complicated system with so many things going on, from ocean currents to wildfires. What's the most important message you'd like the world to hear on this Earth Day?
Well, what I would like to let everyone know is that understanding our Earth is vital for the health of the Earth. And we all have a unique relationship to the Earth, and everyone can make a difference. The way that we make that, we're all consumers, the way that we make decisions, how we vote, everything, we can make different choices. For example, just buying local. By buying local, there's less energy and carbon released into the atmosphere from less transportation of those goods, for example. And also just informing ourselves of what we can do and what NASA is doing to address and better understand the Earth on this Earth Day.
Well, thank you so much for your time, Dr. Bolton. We really enjoyed hearing from you. Thanks so much for the work that you do.
My pleasure. Thank you so much.
Bye now.
Bye-bye.